Alrighty. I hope there's good audio, but alrighty. Now, alrighty. All right. You want to get the lights?
Yes. Or someone's bothering me because they're like, "You don't edit in vertical that you and Ms. Martin doing."
Grr. All right.
Oh, there it is.
There we go. Ooh, ambiance.
Okay. Oh, never mind. Second, the ambiguity at all. Why should I have a stupid black campus? It's dark in my eyes and everything.
All right. Should be recording. I don't know how sensitive my mic is. So if you want to come on this side, too, just in case.
All right. Sunglasses. Just regular glasses with tint.
Just glasses.
All right. Are you ready?
Are we ready? All right. Hey. Lights.
All right. Hey, everyone. Welcome to Creative Tutorials. Today, we're going to be discussing narrative design in video games. My name is Evan Ibarra.
And I'm Caleb Kim.
Awesome. I guess next slide. So essentially, this tutorial is going to, we're going to be breaking it up into two portions to talk about. One is an analysis portion where we're discussing narrative design in games and how it functions. And then we're going to be working hands-on using a type of document called a high concept document to conceptualize how we would tell a story through design. This workshop isn't a writing workshop. It isn't one where you're going to be doing rewrites or having a prompted free write. This isn't necessarily about writing for games. It's more about how you think about implementation of writing in a game. So what narrative design and game writing, they get really often misconstrued. Writing is, they're not inherently of each other. Sometimes on productions, there's two separate people that write and do narrative design, but it could be the same person that does both. Narrative design is the design of how players interact with the game, while game writing is the story itself. Writing is the story, while design is how you interact with it. So narrative design, like, it exists in not just in games, but in books as well. Like, there's a lot of speculative literature that uses how you hold the book and how you physically look at pieces of text to then create the story you're reading. There's a book called House of Leaves. Each time you read it differently because your eyes look at different parts of the text on the pages in a different way each time. So if you read something first before something else, you then read it differently than someone else may read it. And it's also used in performance art. It's like a lot of like experimental plays of like the 20th century are really interested with like audience interaction. And there's like a whole movement kind of about the immersion of the audience as a participant in the art, especially with like Black Mountain College and poems. Like even if you've seen a poem that's funkily like typographied, like that in a way is its own narrative design because it's forcing you as the reader to interact with this body of text in a way that moves your eye and that you are an active participant in constructing instead of it just being a block of text that you already know. So the focus of this workshop is going to be on the form of story and thus video games as a form of storytelling. We're just reiterating that. But I do want to give some, for context, I'm a film major that specializes in screenwriting and digital media. So I've written a lot of scripts. I got in here for screenwriting. Digital media came later. In all my classes I've taken about screenwriting, they haven't really taught me how to be a better writer. That's never like something like, oh, I'm gonna teach you how to be a better writer. If you ever see any workshops like that, it's bullshit. No one knows. No one knows how to be a better writer. Like one of my teachers was like a showrunner for several shows, like the lead writer. And she's just like, I don't know. You just kind of got to go with your gut. So a lot of the advice I got was read just keep reading things. It could be anything. Like, I love reading Wikipedia articles, like, constantly. And that ties into research. I just collect info. If you want to, like, ask me about random shit, like, honestly, I read way too much. And steal. Yeah, just steal things. It's like the whole Picasso, like, what is it? Borrow blank.
Take what you want.
Good artists borrow, great artists steal.
Yeah, that. Thank you. And so, like, I guess as game writing is much more similar to screenplay writing than it is to general prose. Like, general prose being, like, a book. If you pick up, like, I don't know, like, Fahrenheit 451, it's different than a game version of Fahrenheit 451. God. Because a lot of it is scriptified. And so, for a lot of the writing of a game, you're going to be doing a lot of active voice versus passive voice. That means, like, he ran, or he is running quickly, or, like, with the illies, the adverbs, making it more active, as opposed to a passive, like, you're just simply telling, like, oh, he ran. You want to put the emotion there. And then emphasis on the audience versus the writer, and then leaving room for interpretation, because the best stories, especially like in scripts and screenplays, you don't give everything, no matter the story.
So to begin with the analysis phase, with the introduction done, we have selected a curated sample of four different video games, and we're going to be analyzing how each of these four games implements narrative design and uses mechanics and various other aspects of the medium of a video game, specifically in progressing the story and the narrative. And firstly, we're going to begin with Pathologic.
Okay, so this is Pathologic. I don't know how many people know what Pathologic is. Okay, yeah, well, a few people that I've info-dumped about. Info-dumped too. So Pathologic is, really, I say Pathologic, but there's two separate games that are there. There's Pathologic 1, which came out in 2005, and the one that came out in 2009, which was like a re-sequel, you know, like, kind of a reboot, but also like a sequel. It kind of plays with the first one. Basically, the premise is you play as one of three healers in a town on the Russian steppe at some point during the turn of the 19th century, of the turn of the 20th century, during the advent of a terrible plague. And yeah, this game is very much like a survival RPG, and it's very heady. A lot of people have had a hard time playing the first game because it's designed, honestly, quite terribly. It was made in 2005 Russia, like, what do you expect? But then it's also translated terribly. But it's a really unique game in the sense of how it plays with the concept of play, and really like adapting philosophical concepts into game design that existed in other art forms, and narrative wall breaking, player restrictions, and dialogues and lies. And I'm gonna,
yeah, God, there's a lot of quotes here.
I'm sorry, I went a little ham. So Pathologic is constructed is like kind of fundamentally built in theory, literature, and art history, but it's also really built on a post-Soviet experience. A lot of the people that developed it grew up in the Soviet Union, and when the Soviet Union collapsed, they lived in a post-Soviet Russia. And a lot of literature of that era is talking a lot about disease and plague, but also it's kind of how you kind of reframe your lens, especially with all of the shit you've dealt with, both during the Soviet era and post-Soviet. And this, the most striking example in this is the game is structured like a play. The game takes place over, I believe, 12 days, 13. And each of, there's blocks of these days that are broken up into acts of a play. Act one is, I think, days 1 through 3. And then it goes to, like, I think, act 4. And it's broken up kind of thusly. I think like act 2 is rather like short, and then act 3 is rather long, kind of more like a traditional play. This also reflects the story beats. In the game, you have this, I'm gonna go over it, because I really want to know what we're gonna this thing. I'm sorry. I like looking at this. So at the end of every day, your tasks
doing your task of the day. You're giving them at the beginning of the day. You have to go talk to people. Mainly, this game is really built on talking. It's not built to fight. Honestly, your character really sucks at fighting, and it makes sense because you're a doctor. So your honest goal is to not die. That's it. Every day, your goal is not to die and to complete your task. But the main goal is to not die. And at the end of the day, if you survive the day, you go to the feeder and you see a mime that replays the actions of the previous day and gives you some hints to the next day through mime. A lot of the major characters in, there's two sets of characters that exist like separately in like a weird little microcosm of not really being connected to the story, of being like a NPC that relates to the story of like, oh, this is so-and-so's sister, or this is this character. They're just a type of character that exists, and they're called executors and tragedians, where tragedian is, of course, comes from like playwriting and like acting, and executors. And they both, executors, I'm not as sure on their theatrical basis, but it kind of like they're a boss, executors of like the play itself, but they're also actors. And they are very much like involved in the sort of like fourth wall breaking aspects. Like they will directly talk to the player as opposed to the character. Sometimes they will talk to the character, but also they'll talk to you. And your character is not aware that there is a player for most of the game. However, there is a fourth wall break, which I'll get to in a second. And I guess kind of when it comes to like literature and history, an example of this is the theater of cruelty, which comes from the theater and its double, which is an Artois collection of essays. He was like a absurdist playwright, an actor in like the 20th century. And this is one of his quotes talking about in one of his essays called The Theater and the Plague, which, wow, crazy that this writing influence this game. But it's like, if the essential theater is like the plague, it is not because it is contagious, but because like the plague, it is a revelation, the bringing forth, the extorization of a depth of latent cruelty by means of which all the perverse possibilities of the mind, whether of an individual or people, are localized. Basically kind of a play and a plague both bring out what, or should bring out, what we have been having latent in our minds, bringing up all the like stuff we don't want to talk about or don't want to realize to the forefront, and that's the function of both. So Mark Amorial, who's a character, he's the head of the theater in this town, and he's like the director. And he talks a lot about acting and the function of actors in a story, because at least in the second game, the actors of the theater itself becomes where they treat a lot of the plague victims, and the tragedians and the executors who are the actors of the play are helping on the plague out effort. They're helping out the cure the sickness. So interesting take on medical theater, which is like, it's an interesting pun of like medical theater, but then also like relating to concepts of cruelty and like how in a game like a play, everything's structured for you. Everything's structured for your experience, and the players are kind of destined to their ends, and you don't have a play. You don't have a handle on the controls. The controls are out of your hands in both a play and a game, but they bring up the emotions of wanting that control. And then, yeah, there's utopia. If you go back to the first slide, actually, this is a tidbit. So in Russian, it's more utopia. They got a lot of influence from St. Thomas More's Utopia. So it's just a play on words. But I thought that was fun. But okay, next. Oh God, there's more. God, I added this. Yeah, so basically there's like a lot of multiple narrative, like multiple narrative wall breaks. I say multiple because basically what happens is, this is the beginning of the play. This is what I meant by tragedians will talk to you. Like
Please be kind of mine and linger for a minute. Your dialogue with me won't take much time, especially because time stops during dialogues. If it is important, of course, our dialogue is extremely important. It is connected with the rules of the game. Like, this is the first interaction you have with any character. Is
basically a tutorial discussion. And there's a fourth wall break in a special ending where basically you find out that the entire game has been taking place in a sandbox with children, and you are their dolls. The characters are the dolls. And that's kind of like the first revelation. But then if you go even further and play through the game again, you can get the second revelation where it's the developers literally talking to you, the player, being like, why have you played this so much? What are you trying to look for? This is just a game. And yeah, there's like an emphasis on the fact that it's not real, and the survival mechanics force you to simulate this reality, even though you yourself know it's not real. This is a game you're playing on your computer, but the mechanics of the game that force you to stressfully stay alive make the story so impactful and make it hard to disconnect yourself from the game you play. And it really begs the question, does a game need to be fun? But yeah, they're dolls. All the characters are dolls. I took a long time. Sorry about that.
No, you're good. We're going to take a little bit of a mental break from all this fourth wall breaking, and we're going to be talking about Celeste. I'll keep this one a little bit brief because Celeste being a very, very well known, who here has heard of Celeste? Yeah, exactly. So, you know, a majority of the people that we're going to, you know, you're going to know, you will have heard of Celeste more than likely. And as a result, it's been analyzed to death. It's a nice 2018 game from Canadian developer Maddie Makes Games. And as you'd expect, it's a platformer. And so you play as Madeline, who's a young woman determined to climb Mount Celeste. And the most obvious analogy from the writing standpoint is that Mount Celeste is supposed to be an extended metaphor for the struggles of overcoming mental health. And that in and of itself has been analyzed to death, and you can go watch video essays for that. But uniquely to this, death is pretty inconsequential. The game will make fun of you for dying a lot. In fact, there's certain collectibles that are locked behind not dying. But relatively speaking, Celeste does not punish you for dying. And that ties into some of the narrative design with difficulty. There are collectibles everywhere, and overall the game is pretty conducive to speedrunning, which kind of plays into some the narrative design in other directions. So mechanics are gradually introduced kind of in a way that parallels how you have to learn to overcome certain hurdles in life. If you look at how the level design is conducive to this, you can look at any time a new mechanic is introduced. My favorite chapter in Celeste is chapter 2, the old site where you have the dream blocks. And at first you go through it and you realize you have to dash through it and you just kind of go straight through. It's a relatively intuitive way for the game mechanics to introduce an a concept. And the way that parallels, at least my interpretation of how that parallels with the extended metaphor for mental health, is the idea that something might look very easy and intuitive. You kind of get into it, but then you realize, oh shit, there's a lot more than that. There's like so much more, because the puzzles that they do in the B and C side stories take these very simple rudimentary mechanics and they push it to the limit. And so that's kind of analogous to the idea of you have to learn, but even if you learn certain mechanisms to be dealing with certain obstacles or challenges in your life, there's always going to be something more difficult, but you have to keep pushing through. This is why death is a very simple and relatively inconsequential mechanic in this game. You die because it is a difficult game. However, you're not punished for it. You don't have to start over some far distance, like, you know, there's no life counter, none of that. It is purely start over from the exact position you started at the beginning of the screen. It's very forgiving, and that is by design. It is specifically designed so that you can just get back and try again. Not only because it's a pretty good quality of life feature, let's admit, it's also just supposed to be analogous of you can keep going, right? You want to keep going. It's going to be difficult. Some screens might take you tens, hundreds, maybe even thousands of attempts to get it perfectly. But even then, you can keep going, no matter how far in or how close to the beginning of the stage of the screen you were. You start back at the beginning and you just try again. One of the most interesting parts is the fan dub, and internally, I think Battle Line is internally referenced as Battle Line in the code, but in the game, she's always referred to as part of you, which is to say you're literally running away from a part of you, starting in the dream sequence in chapter 2. And in chapter 3, she comes into the real world and angers Mr. Oshiro, and that's what causes the rest of the level. And so for those early parts of the design, it is the gameplay mechanic of, oh no, if you touch her, she dies. And you can boil that down to a simple few lines of code in Unity. And so it's just a death, if you think about it. But from the narrative perspective, you are literally running away from a target that is chasing you incessantly until you have to go and cross the screen. That is the only way that the battle line clones despawn. However, if you, spoilers, I guess, towards the later chapters, Madeline and Madeline make up with each other and they have to work together. And part of you literally becomes a part of you, emphasized by her hair color change in the later chapters and this, the ability of a second dash. And one of my favorite quotes from the introduction to Madeline is her saying, "You can't handle this," to which Madeline responds, "That's exactly why I need to do this." And so this is where I go on this mantra about weaving difficulty in storytelling, because it may not seem like much at first, especially for a game as it's not, I personally don't think Celeste is rage inducing while it is difficult, but for a game like this to be so forgiving in death, the idea is that you're weaving the very difficult, mechanically demanding challenges of certain screens and even certain, some of the B and C sides. Like if you look at the Celeste wiki, they're actually like, it's actually hard coded to allow like wave dashing, super jumping. Like the mechanics are actually there to teach you, because if you discover those tech, it makes a lot, you know, it's conducive to overcoming these difficulties. Certain mechanics like wave dashing aren't ever directly taught or even stated in the game, but they are programmed in the game. And so you're able to use that the challenge of trying to overcome this, and you can overcome certain levels in different ways. And let me tell you, it is very difficult. Some of those screens, like I haven't even 100% in this game, and I don't think I ever will, because it's just too hard. But the difficulty is, again, analogous to the idea of this game is difficult because it's talking about a mentally difficult subject. And so with that, back to your regularly scheduled mind-blowing. Who here has heard of the game 9 hours, 9 persons, 9 doors? That's what I thought. And so this game is what I like to call a cult classic. It is a 2009 game developed by Chunsoft, which you might recognize as a developer, the studio behind Danganronpa, as well as some of the DS Pokemon Mystery Dungeon games, as a matter of fact. So Chunsoft is somewhat well known, and they have a decent repertoire underneath their belt. But buckle up, this is gonna be a bit of an info dump, and I apologize in advance. So I couldn't really think of what to put for the type of game, but what I would describe it as is an escape room visual novel with a lot of thriller elements to it. Because in a sense, it is a death game. So you follow Junpei, one of 9 people who was gassed and kidnapped aboard a ship, which is the replica of the sister ship to the Titanic, the Gigantic, and you are forced to play a death game known as the Nonary game. There are some number of doors that are labeled a certain number on it, and in order to get out, you have 9 hours until the ship sinks, and you have to get through the door labeled 9, and if you fail to follow any of the rules, well, you have bracelets on all the characters have a bracelet on their arm and a bomb planted in their chest. And if they fail to abide by any of the rules, that bomb detonates. And so there's the death game part of it. However, one of the most unique aspects of this game is that you are outright required to get a specific bad ending to get the true ending. And so as you'd expect with a lot of visual novels, especially in this kind of escape room, people can die style of death game VN, there are multiple endings. However, it also uses the fact that it is a video game and not just the fact that, oh, hey, look, you're a player playing this game. It takes full advantage of the fact that it is a video game. Moreover, the fact that it is on the DS, which I'll get into a little bit later. And of course, fourth wall breaks. And so if you're tired of hearing like Doki Doki Literature Club fourth wall breaks, good. That's why I chose this game, because I was right in that Only one person in this room has heard of it. So this game is what I would like to call a science fiction game in disguise. And so initially, 999 presents itself as just a Saw-like death game. You have, it's very kind of grounded in reality. Everyone has bracelets, and they're, and the reason why I say it's a thriller is because everyone is forced to do math to survive. And so each of the bracelets is numbered 1 through 9. So there are 9 different characters, and you follow Junpei. There's Ace, who has the 1, Snake, who has the 2, Santa with the 3, Clover with the 4, Junpei with 5, June with 6, 7 with 7, he's an amnesiac, Lotus with 8, and the 9th man who dies first. And so before I get into some of that, I want to talk about this, the read, research, steal type deal. And that's the fact that when I was discussing this with Evan, I realized that a lot of these concepts were stolen from Kurt Vonnegut. And so the novel Cat's Cradle was actually indirectly, you know, this is an indirect product of that. As the concept of Ice Nine comes from Cat's Cradle, as well as the name of a major antagonistic force in the novel Cradle Pharmaceuticals, well, it's the namesake. And so that plays very heavily into the plot and this idea of it's an existing concept. As long as you're not plagiarizing it, well, better artists steal. And so other aspects that that kind of creep into the story over time includes what we would call pseudoscience, but is actually real science in this universe, is the theory of morphogenetic fields, which is basically just an invisible medium for psychic and telepathic communication. And so these are reflected in what's known as Ganzfeld experiments, which is German for great field, I believe. And so these were real experiments that happened by German scientists over the turn of the 20th century to try and test the legitimacy of some supposed morphogenetic telepathic inducing field. As it turns out, unfortunately, in real life, they were a failure. They don't exist. However, these concepts are slowly brought in through the narrative in the universe of 999. And so this game foreshadows a lot. And so buckle up, this is where a lot of the info dump happens. So I apologize in advance for that. But the reason why this game, I believe, is one of the best examples of using bad endings and multiple endings is because it is fully predicated on the idea that certain timelines, you'll get access to different information. If you've ever played a game that has multiple endings, you, the player, might be frustrated because you know something happens in a completely different universe or a different timeline, but just the players just have no idea because it never happened to them. This game says they have an actual explanation for why that is and how they can kind of sidestep that. So there is a major point in almost all of the bad endings in which the character named Snake, he's a tall, blind, intelligent man who you see the corpse of in that got blown up in the shower room on the ship. And so there's a particular bad ending where Clover, his younger sister, as you learn, ends up axing everybody to death because they feel like they killed the blind man. And so they're like, she's like, you know, you killed my brother, and she doesn't know who it is. So she just axes everybody. And that is probably the most terrifying bad ending because there's a CG of her just blankly staring with her hand out like, come on, get up, after she just axed you in the back. And so there are other endings where Junpei learns different information. And so the reason why you need to get a particular bad ending known as the safe ending is because that is the only route in the entire game where Junpei learns certain critical pieces of information. The first piece of information is that Snake has a prosthetic left arm, and the corpse that they found that was wearing his clothes has a human left arm. And that piece of information was never conveyed to Clover, hence the axe ending, where she kills everyone because she thinks that they killed her brother. And so that realization and telling her that this corpse can't be his because it has a human arm, a human left arm, where Snake has a prosthetic, that's one piece of information that Clover then learns. Additionally, the CEO of the antagonistic group, Cradle Pharmaceuticals, is one of the players in the death game. And his identity is Ace. And he is the one responsible for murdering other people in other timelines. He's the killer. The third piece of information that Junpei learns is the fact that this nonary game is not the first one, that there is the existence of a previous nonary game that happened 9 years in the past, and that it was all just a big Ganzfeld experiment.
all 8 characters actually are chosen for a reason. And this death game was actually set up specifically to retcon the events, preventing a grandfather paradox and saving the lives, saving the life of Akane, who is known as June, who holds the 6th bracelet, and June Pei's childhood friend. And so the entire point of this Saw-like death game is to fix a grandfather paradox. And the only way that this happens, you have to get the specific safe bad ending, because otherwise Junpei gets to the what's known as the coffin ending, where it says, what is the passcode? What was Junpei supposed to do? There's a hint in a safe, hence the safe ending, that Junpei finds in that ending that has the combination to open the coffin. And inside the coffin is an alive and well snake. And so in all the other bad endings, the coffin is never opened, only in the safe ending and the true ending. However, this is what really gets crazy. Junpei in the true ending learns, because the safe ending Junpei transmitted telepathically the information, the combination to the coffin, thereby allowing him to just know this. And all the other bits of information that I mentioned that only exist in the safe ending is what differentiates the coffin ending from the true ending, because Junpei knows things he shouldn't know. And so there's a handy dandy timeline that explains all the different ways that you can get all the different endings. And so if you notice that if you look at the one that goes to door one, regardless, the only way that you don't get the axe ending on past door one, because is the situation where the story checks are passed, e.g. Clover is aware that Snake is still alive. That is the only timeline in which she knows this. And so assuming you pass all the story checks, and that Junpei, another timeline, has learned the combination, because only the bottom root Junpei has ever learned the combination to the safe. If all of those are true, then and only then is the true ending route even accessible. And it's all because of the many worlds interpretation. And so if that isn't weird enough, this game breaks the fourth wall by literally having a hole in the fourth wall. And so one of the other pieces of information that Junpei learns is that Akane holds not the 6th bracelet, but the 9th bracelet upside down. And that is reflected by when you flip over the box art upside down, Junpei has the 5 still, and Akane, instead of having a 6th bracelet, has the 9th bracelet. And that is another key piece of information that mathematically worked out in all the puzzles. And here's the even crazier part. Remember when I said that this game, it has a Steam port and a console port, but the definitive version is the DS, because the story was designed for the DS. How do I mean? If you've ever played on a DS, you know that the top screen is not interactable at all. It is purely a conduit for the player to see. The bottom screen is touchscreen and therefore is the interactive one. Throughout the game, Junpei talks in first person with all the other characters on the top screen, and the bottom screen appears to be an omniscient narrator. Remember when I said that the whole point of the second Nonary game is to retcon a grandfather paradox? That was because the bottom screen was never an omniscient narrator at all, but instead the person you're trying to save 9 years ago telepathically communicating with Junpei 9 years in the future with the information required for him to solve the final puzzle and therefore save her life, therefore allowing this Nonary game to even have happened in the first place. And so the entire bottom screen always referred to Junpei in the third person. It's because it was never a narrator. You yourself, the player, was in fact the conduit by which information traveled between timelines. You yourself are not Junpei. You are the morphogenetic field that is transmitting information, all because only people outside the realm of the game are able to retain information between timelines. Mind's blown yet? And that is why you guys should play 9 hours, 9 doors. No, there's still a lot more that I didn't even cover in this. And so if your mind isn't sufficiently blown yet, well, you have one more case study for you.
I don't know how to talk.
Are you going to be talking about spoilers?
No spoilers. This has no spoilers. I didn't have spoilers. Well, there were spoilers for Pathological 1, but it came out in 2005. So I was playing if you didn't play the 2005
version, just play Pathologic 2.
Just play Pathologic 2. Like, I didn't spoil anything for Pathologic 2. Like, I think I don't even know what to spoil for Pathologic 2. Okay, so Disco Elysium. How many people know what Disco Elysium is or played it? Okay, Slay. I love Disco Elysium. It was with me at the beginning of the pandemic. If anyone had me, Kim Kitsuragi had me. Basically, the premise, for one, it was 2019. It was developed, I could say 2020 for the Final Cut version of it, which was the fully dubbed. They added some stuff to it. It was weird. The Final Cut was weird. Developers, it was Zaloom that was made. I need to be stressed that it's Estonia and the UK, the Estonian aspect. Both Pathologic and Disco Elysium are quintessentially post-Soviet games because they're both about post-Soviet identity. So you can tell So it's a single-player RPG, and it's really based on traditional TTRPG mechanics, and the player is not at an advantage. And unlike a lot of RPGs that really state dialogue, there's a concept that if you're using exposition, it's a visual novel. If you're using just dialogue, it's a role-playing game. There's both narration and exposition and dialogue, and also just different aspects that aren't necessarily characters talking at the same time, kind of in a fragmented mind-esque type of way that really diverges from both visual novels and role-playing games as we know them in a typical sense. The premise of the game is that you play as a cop, you must investigate a murder in a seaside town after waking up from a drug and alcohol fueled bender that has left him completely amnesia. That's your character. His name's Harry. He's great. Next slide. So I think what's really important for Disco Elysium, and really analyzing it, is the development context of the game. So this game started as a D&D campaign between friends. It started just as a homebrew type situation, where they just came up with an idea and they ran with it. And they kept all the characters in the game. Some of them are developers. There's the developers' characters in the game. A lot of the cops are those characters that the developers played as when they played it as a TTRPG. And a big aspect of this game is about addiction, because your character is coming out of a terrible bender and you're getting judged for it, kind of justifiably. You've been an alcoholic for a while, and it's kind of destroyed all of your relationships and your life. And this D&D campaign, this aspect of recovery that's really important to the game that I think gets overlooked a lot, is because this tabletop RPG helps both the main writer and other developers into recovery and out of alcoholism because of post-Soviet Russia. Well, not Russia, Estonia in this case, where it was really common. It kind of saved them in a way, this story. And they first wrote it as a novel, and then they decided to develop it as a game. And it has a very, very visual novel-esque storytelling format with basically kind of a film strip running on the left side, the right side of the screen, with text that's mainly just prose-esque, where it's written like a book, where it's she stares out of the window, not really hearing your words. That's you read in a book, which would make you think it's a visual novel, but it's emulated in a TTRPG style by using dice rolls to decide all of your skill checks. Kind of as you do in a tabletop game, when you have to do something and you have to roll for constitution, that's a dice roll. And in this game, most of your dice rolls are shit. You really are bad at rolling dice. At least I would say in my playthroughs of it, I've been really bad at rolling dice. And this dice roll aspect is really important to the game thematically. Even it's explicitly stated, this is a character you meet kind of offhandedly. I don't even think she's a mandatory meet. She's just some lady that gives you dice and talks about dice for a long time. But she says this: "That's why people like role-playing games. You can be whoever you want to be. You can try again. Still, there's something inherently violent even about dice rolls. It's like every time you cast a die, something disappears. Some alternate ending or an entirely different world. She picks up a pair of dice from the table and examines them under the light. If I recall correctly, she gives you those dice. This game is kind of an homage to role-playing games and so on. It's a celebration of the form and especially of the tabletop form of the game, where a lot of, like, every RPG game you've ever played has come from people who love tabletop games. If it's like a, like Fallout, Fallout was developed originally as like a really like rudimentary role-playing game. And I believe there is a tabletop version of the game from like all the way back when, or even Cyberpunk 2077, like that was originally a tabletop game in like, I believe even in the 80s or the 90s. But like there's a big, tabletop is always a basis of it, but something we kind of forget about at times, especially when right now where a lot of things are in video games. So there's a kind of a separation between the two when really both groups love each. So the player is at a disadvantage throughout the entire game, especially at the beginning of it. Like when you're playing at the beginning, there's this character named Colosse, and you could try flirting with her. You see the suggestion very low. It typically goes bad. You can't even see your face at the beginning of the game because typically you cannot make a skill shot that good. You can't roll that well. So you can't even see your own reflection in the mirror that you're trying to clean off. Sometimes you don't even get your tie off of the ceiling. Like everything is not going well. And you will stumble and bumble and fail more often than you'll actually succeed. And you're at a social disadvantage. It's very humanistic, the responses that the player gives you. Like in a lot of RPG games, people give you the benefit of the doubt and they treat you like in a very unrealistic way of like, oh, you just stumbled in looking like shit. I'm gonna help you. I'm a good person. My wife died. Like that's not my RPG go. But in this game, like people distrust you because you are quite obviously someone that has just come out of a bender and you're a cog. No one likes cogs. And the effects of the player's past actions, which you have no control on, are still tangible. And that's really important to have that disconnect of it is still your character. You can't separate your character pre-amnesia from your character now. They are somewhat, sorry, I got like really distracted. I thought the starship was making the skateboard noise. Like, stop picking it that loud. But that's kind of the point. When a lot of the times, like in when you're still actively in an addiction, like your character is not actively in recovery at the moment. He's still an addict. It's your choice to go into recovery. It's your choice to be sober in the game, even though you kind of need drugs to do better at things. But
what?
like sometimes you need drugs to like be a little better or to heal yourself. Oh god. To be a little better, to like fight a guy. I think if you beat up Meathead, who's this like weird racist guy. There's a lot of weird racist people in there, but that's like, it's also part of the story. We're not getting there. This isn't about story. You're still actively in addiction and people judge you based on them. Kind of like how they do today. It's just, we're sober. We don't think about that when we're talking to people. Or like, maybe you're sober. I don't know. Like, it's even like you, if you're not an addict, you don't assume that somebody's going to judge you based on your actions, but you actively judge people who are probably like, you'd be like, oh my gosh, that guy's tweaking out or whatever. But there's a real person there. And that's kind of the point of the game, of you are a real person who's really making choices and really trying to deal with your own stuff. You have a lot of hurdles. It's not discounting the fact you have a lot of hurdles. This even goes into the traits and the mental health stuff. You're really mentally ill in the game. That's kind of part of it. Like, you're really in a bad place, and this is all affecting you, but you can choose to be better. You can choose to be how you are, and you have your reasons for it. It's very humanistic. You're putting yourself in the shoes of an addict, of making a choice of recovery, and the main companion, Kim Kitsurugi, is kind of the... I feel like a very common thing in recovery is having that friend that's just kind of with you no matter what. Yeah, they may be like judging you, but like you want to please Kim. when you're playing the game. Like, I could, like, there's several achievements you can get for being like Kim hate you. I still haven't gotten it because I don't want to make Kim disappointed in me. Because Kim makes you feel really great. He doesn't infantilize you or anything. He still kind of judges you, but he still hopes for good. And that's a really big motivator of the game. Like, everybody loves Kim against Rodney. And your traits and your mental health are really interesting in the sense of your traits talk to you, but it's kind of reflecting like a fragmented mental health state and like your own fragmented personality as you're coming out of really amnesiac bender. But it gives you stuff, a hints of extraordinary hitting about the past. They help you like remember things or give you like little hints that you wouldn't have already gotten from social. You almost have like superpowers in that way, but it's just you're really fucking mentally ill. Like, which honestly is such a mood, but like there's these characters you meet on like, I think it's the third day, and it's your former partner from your original station, because Kim is not your partner. He's just a guy, he's like from a different department, but your actual partner from your own department comes and he's really fucking pissed at you for this one, for just everything that's happened. And he dresses up with another person from your department in disguise to kind of spy on you, but you don't know who he is. But a part of you thinks you do. A part of you remembers. And it's a Espiritu du Corpus. It's kind of like more of one of the sensitive, more abstract, more of the past, the self aspects of your trait system. And he's like, there's something that binds you to him. Some kind of outfit, maybe a uniform. You have hints of like you recollecting the fragmentation of the traits talking to you in dialogue. They cannot be heard by players, by the NPC, the only to yourself, the player. They create very like reflective way of thinking about that. I don't know.
So you
other games.
I mean, yeah, you've heard us spitball for 40 minutes straight. How amazing.
I'm
great.
So sorry.
I am too. But yeah. any other good ways of narrative design that comes to mind? Anything that integrates into gameplay mechanics, hardware, fourth wall breaks, any other ideas?
Stanley Parable.
Stanley Parable is a really good example of that.
Stanley Parable
2. True. Yep.
Shot.
Oh.
One shot.
We have one shot fan in here.
I don't have my one shot jacket with me. Yeah.
So yeah, the big thing that we wanted to emphasize is that you guys know what a good story looks like. The creative part is how you can weave that into mechanics, controls, fourth wall breaks, and use the fact that we're playing the most intersectional and interactive media that exists. And so the whole idea behind all of this is to get you guys thinking about how you want to apply what you know about a good story and how you can convey that better, fully utilizing this medium. And so now,
I just wanted to say, I think like everything you write, like when a thing is written in a script form, is it like if it's written to be a play, it's a play. It's performed like a play is. If you write a script for a film, it's typically adapted to a film. It fits the media. Like if I'm writing a TV script and I'm writing a 30-minute sitcom, the script is going to look like a 30-minute sitcom because that's the form. It's 30 minutes with an act structure that fits it to like what is it called, advertisements. It's constructed in that way to fit the form. Your story is. In the same way, games, when you're writing for a game, you're writing to the form, but the form is very vast, it's malleable, but it should be as, you don't need to think, oh, well, I'm making an RPG so it needs to look like this, or I'm making Link, it needs to look like this. You can add and manipulate the form as much to fit the story as best it can. It's like throwing a vase away, you know? Like you're molding, like that's what you call like throwing clay. It's like how you move. That's the phrase for it. Like, I'm sorry, Matt just gave me like a loose look and I was like, that's a phrase, right? Okay.
You're throwing a pot.
I don't know. I shouldn't be smart. You're the one that asked me what a scene was, so okay.
Exposed.
Okay.
So yeah, now that we've got you primed to think about that, we're gonna enter phase two, the workshop phase.
Yeah.
So who here has a laptop? If you have a laptop, I sent in announcements without a ping, a link to it. Well, I did that. It's because I did it at the start. And so I linked a document called a high concept document. If you guys want to go file, make a copy. I also have 10 hard printout copies in there. Each is 3 pages. They're not stapled. I'm sorry. So if you don't have any kind of device, I have something physical for you. But does anyone want the physical copy? Okay.
Yeah, I don't have that. You're totally good.
Yeah, it should just take the first 3 pages. The paper is not very good at separating. I can't count either.
You're a math major.
Math majors can't count.
No, no, they're just broke.
Okay, that's my name.
It's really weirdly formatted. It's a book within a book talking about a movie that doesn't exist, about a house that doesn't exist.
Whoa, I know this.
It's okay. The book is basically this guy finds this academic paper talking about a documentary that a photojournalist who doesn't exist, and this documentary also doesn't exist, about a house that's really weird, that also doesn't exist. Like, those who carry it around, it's kind of a break. Okay, anybody else want paper?
Yeah, any other hard copies?
Any other hard copy takers? I can give you a pen if you would like. So we sent you a document with it. Just it's for viewer, just copy, make a copy of it. Oh, you want one?
And a pen, please.
Yeah, I can give you a pen. I got a pen.
What are you doing? So it's essentially a pitch deck for a document for a game. It's supposed to be concise, to the point, and it can also be used as an organization tool, but it's mostly to kind of get the premise down as if you are trying to, you know, to propose it. It's also a good way of developing expectations when you're pitching it. And so
I found this. Let's go into the next slide. I'll show you an example. If you want an example, I'm gonna scan this. So for college, when I was applying to colleges, I applied. NYU game stuff, and I use this document with game design and concept and like character concept, and I applied there. I got it, so I guess it was good. Like,
it was good.
I got in with a 50k scholarship, so you know, whatever. Like,
the flex,
the way that like mental health, I also was going for a manic episode, so like,
who wanted to scan it?
Yeah, it's just an example.
Okay,
And yeah, we've made a kind of editable version of it that's going to be in the Discord that you can use for like your SSS, SRS,
yeah,
project proposals, your own game dev stuff. It's really open to you. I just took his original document and edited it to be usable.
See, easily accessible. See, this is why going to creative track is the pipeline to SRS team leads. this is all a ploy the entire time.
It's a whole time.
We planned it out well in advance, and definitely not at 2 in the morning.
What if we
no, we totally didn't like no, send text
over. We definitely did not. So if you guys have any burning ideas, we encourage you to, you know, any concepts that you had in mind from the analysis phase, have fun and go on. The rest of this is just going to be working on this, and you can collaborate with people. And if you're comfortable towards the end, like,
we'll just share out.
Yeah, you could share out. And
yeah. If you want any prompts and stuff, I can prompt you. I don't know. This one was literally based off of me being obsessed with Roman Holiday playing Nicki Minaj. So that was how I came up with the entire game. It's you combine bipolar disorder with medication that fucked up with Nicki Minaj. And then you're like, okay, you need to submit a portfolio. It's like, fuck. And then I made that. So yeah, I don't know. Go through Spotify, come up with something fun. If you have an idea, make that put your idea down. But yeah.
But yeah. I guess I'll just end the recording now. I had it in the slideshow, but I'll put it in the recording as well.
Yeah.
So, Ray, this is evidence that we did in fact remember to do this. Don't fire me.
I love it. Like, can we be fired? We're not even getting paid. Like, this is volunteer. Can we be fired for being a volunteer?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'll put this back up at the end, but I just wanted to get it in the recording.
Yeah, if you want to like talk, ask questions, chilling. I don't know.